Dilly Minutesummer 1445 met een uitzending van vandaag 20 oktober 2018. En het inspreken is nog best een uitdaging met een wilde kattenbaby op schoot. Die probeert alleen maar in mijn handen te bijten, maar goed, het gaat tot nog te goed. Dit is het bulletin van zaterdag. Vandaag geen data, maar één nieuwsbericht in het Nederlands en uitgebreid nieuws in het Engels. Een leuk middengolfnieuwtje is het volgende. Extra AM 1224 gaat vanaf november uitzenden vanaf een bijzondere historische locatie, namelijk het Remeiland in Amsterdam. Het Remeiland ligt sinds 2011 in het IJ in Amsterdam, waar het onder andere een restaurant huisvest. Het station brengt non-stop classic hits en er is ook ruimbaan voor die andere oldies die je vandaag de dag zelden of nooit meer hoort op de radio. Inmiddels is er een hele worsteling met de kattenbaby. Volgens de website van het station zijn de initiatiefnemers van dit project een aantal hobbyisten die hun sporen hebben verdiend bij enkele commerciële radioomroepen. Extra AM wordt uit eigen middelen en sponsoring gefinancierd. Ze zijn nog bezig met een andere frequentie, want de huidige wordt in de avond en de nacht gestoord door een buitenlandse zender. Vandaar dat we op AM voorlopig tussen 8 uur en 1900 uur uitzenden. Aldus de website van het station, en dat is extram.nl, dus met 1 A, extram.nl of extram.nl.
This is ARRL Audio News, your weekly summary of news highlights from the world of amateur radio.
I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, and these are our stories for Friday, October 19th. More than a week after Hurricane Michael ravaged northern Florida, news is still coming in about amateurs who answered the call of service during the storm as well as in the aftermath. Miller Norton, W4EMN, the Communications Watch Officer at the Duval County Emergency Operations Center, or EOC, in Jacksonville, Florida, was monitoring SARnet, a UHF-linked repeater network in Florida, when he heard an urgent call for help that needed to be sent to the state EOC in Tallahassee. All other forms of communication were out, but Norton was able to relay the message via amateur radio. He also passed along messages and requests from the Jackson County EOC to the American Red Cross. Norton said officials in Tallahassee and Jackson County were both incredibly grateful for the way the SARnet system functioned during the weather emergency. Jackson County Emergency Coordinator Ricky Whittington, KD4AST, deployed to the county EOC in Mariana. He said, quote, "We took a direct hit by the center of the storm at 140 miles per hour. The county maintenance building across the road from the EOC was picked up and slammed into the north side and over the roof of the EOC just prior to the eye passing over," unquote. The incident took out the HF antenna, which has since been restored. Until recently, hams in the area have been passing material and resource orders to the state EOC via HF and SARnet. In many counties, including Bay, Jackson, Leon, and Gulf, amateur radio was the only form of communication for nearly a day after the storm passed through. Aries activated in Escambia County to support two shelters. Citrus County Aries was called to provide communication support for four shelters. More than 230 items will be on the block as bidding gets underway for the 13th annual ARRL online auction on Friday, October 19th at 10 a.m. Eastern Time, 1400 UTC. The auction will continue through Friday, October 26th at 10 p.m. Eastern Time, 0200 UTC on Saturday, October 27th. The 2018 auction includes lab-tested QST product review gear, vintage books, used equipment, and one-of-a-kind items, plus the ARRL lab team has contributed four of the very popular mystery boxes. All bidders must register, and please note, your ARRL.org user ID and password will not work on the auction site. If you have registered for a previous ARRL online auction, you may use the same login information. If you have forgotten your user ID or password, click on the Help tab for instructions on how to retrieve these credentials. Please make sure your correct address and other information are up to date. The ARRL Contest Branch has announced that participants in the 2019 ARRL Ready Roundup will be permitted to use the new FDA protocol, which is part of the WSJTX software suite. Some limitations will apply to FT8 entrants. Participants must use WSJTX version 2.0 or later to ensure they are able to transmit and receive the exchange messages the event requires. No unattended operation, including QSO macro automations, will be allowed. Neither is FT8's Fox and Hounds mode. Each contact must be carried out in a one-to-one mode, manually accepting and logging each contact. Since ARRL contest rules regarding spotting assistance prohibit the use of automated multi-channel decoders by single operator entrants, stations using software that decodes more than one FT8 signal at a time will have to enter as single operator unlimited or as multi-operator, just as PSK participants have had to do in the past when using FL Digi or Digipan software. The International Amateur Radio Union Monitoring Service reports interference on 40 meters from various Russian sources. The Russian coastal over-the-horizon radar Sunflower was very active on 40 meters and audible in Europe in the evenings. The site is believed to be northeast of Vladivostok. In addition, a Russian ship was observed transmitting RIDI on 7.110 MHz. The vessel was believed to be in the area around and east of Cyprus. Another Russian ship was heard on September 18th transmitting digital communications with a 2.6 kHz bandwidth in the area of Crete. And a Russian military system, believed to be near Moscow, was heard transmitting on 7.198 MHz. Some 450 sites in the U.S. are among nearly 3,000 locations around the world that will host Jamboree on the Air, otherwise known as JOTA, over the October 19th through 21st weekend. One site that will be activated for JOTA is the Voice of America, or VOA, Museum in Westchester, Ohio, which hosts the Westchester Amateur Radio Association's club station, WC8VOA. Club member Jocelyn Brout, KD8VRX, grew up in Canada, where, as a 12-year-old, he took part in a JOTA event, making a friend in France and becoming pen pals. Years later, he became a scout leader and a radio amateur. The station in the VOA has been hosting JOTA for the past 5 years and allows anyone in scouting to participate from the museum. The Pacific Islands De-Expedition Group is hoping to gain approval of its latest application for a de-expedition from Cure Atoll, currently the seventh most wanted DXCC entity according to Clublog. The last ham radio activity on Cure Atoll took place in 2005. Once home to a U.S. Coast Guard Loran station, Cure Atoll is part of Hawaii, although separated from the rest of the state by Midway Island. The Hawaii Department of Land and Natural Resources formally denied the prior application last June. The Pacific Islands De-Expedition Group said no provisions are in place to appeal the decision, although a letter accompanying the denial package indicated that the group was welcome to submit another application in the future, which it did on August 6th. After 18 months of intensive planning, the 14-member international VP6D team is now en route on the long voyage to Ducie Island from Mangareva, French Polynesia, aboard the MV Braveheart. The team rendezvoused in Tahiti before flying to Mangareva and set sail on October 16th. The de-expedition is scheduled to begin on October 20th and continue until November 3rd.
And now with this week's satellite update, here's Bruce Page, KK5DO.
On or about October 18th, AO7 will enter a period of full illumination that will last approximately until November 19th. During this time, the satellite's onboard timer should switch it between mode A and mode B every 24 hours. Mode VA, or as we call mode A, linear transponder is non-inverting. It's for sideband or CW. The uplink is 145.850 through 145.950 MHz, and the downlink is 29.400 through 29.500. The non-inverting means if your uplink is at the bottom end of the passband, the downlink will also be at the bottom end of the passband. Tuning one makes the other go up as well. Mode UV, or what we call Mode B linear transponder, is inverting, and it's for sideband or CW. The uplink is 432.125 through 432.175 MHz, and the downlink is 145.975 through 145.925 MHz. The inverting means if your uplink is at the bottom end of the passband, the downlink will be at the top end of the passband. Tuning higher on the uplink will make the downlink tune down. Eventually, they will meet in the middle and cross. You may want to check the keps and times of passes for the ISS over the United States. Serena KG5TMT has randomly announced, "Hello, America. This is the International Space Station. Who's out there?" She will then pleasantly make QSOs. Listen for her on 145.800 MHz FM and transmit on the frequency for our region. However, be prepared to switch to another region's uplink if she does not answer you. Sometimes they forget to change their listening frequency when they pass over another region. The astronauts used to spend a little time on the air now and then making random QSOs. Be sure to thank her for the QSO. No, you cannot use the contact for a grid square, and no, it does not count for any ARRL or AMSAT awards. It's a nice contact you will talk about for a long time, even if you made a contact with an astronaut in the past. Thanks to the AMSAT News Service for this week's stories. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO, for the ARRL Audio News.
I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and this is the ARRL Audio News Propagation Forecast for Friday, October 19th. We had a couple of weak sunspots earlier in the week, but they've almost completely faded from view. In fact, by the time you hear this, we'll likely be back to our usual spotless sun. With a weak solar flux index, you'll find your best chances for long-haul contacts on 80 and 40 meters. And the closer we get to winter, the better conditions we'll get on 160 meters. Earth is still within the stream of solar particles that plagued us last week, and they're likely to cause some disturbances with some possible geomagnetic storms in the forecast for the next several days. On VHF and UHF, we're seeing some band openings on 2 meters in northern Florida and southern Georgia, and another cluster of activity that seems to be centered on Oklahoma.
And that concludes ARRL Audio News for this week. Our thanks to all contributors to this week's report. ARRL Audio News is produced by the American Radio Relay League, the National Association for Amateur Radio. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at arrl.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment about ARRL Audio News, email us at audionews@arrl.org. This program is copyright ARRL, all rights reserved. 73, and thanks for listening.
I'm Ono of the Foundations of Amateur Radio podcast in Australia, and you're listening to the Daily Minutes by Papa Alpha Zero Echo Tango Echo. Foundations of Amateur Radio. Mistakes are common in all aspects of life. Sometimes they're only known to you. Other times they're public knowledge and open to ridicule and lambasting. Getting on air for the first time is an accomplishment and often the initial source of mistakes, mishaps, and great frustration. Once you've made it on air, the reception to this feat is often underwhelming. People around you don't appear to appreciate the amount of effort you went to in order to key your microphone and for others to be able to hear that. If you've been in this community for a while, it's easy to forget what is involved to make that first contact, and to dismiss those around you who've managed to obtain their license, acquire their equipment, install and configure it just so, and to actually achieve the first visible milestone in their amateur radio journey, though technically it's audible. If you've never done this, or if you have but have delegated to the historical backwaters of your mind, here's an outline of some steps and mistakes along the path of making your first contact. The first question you're likely to ask is, which radio, followed quickly by, from where? Then, if you're like me, and many other starting amateurs, you'll have set up your radio for operation on the local 2-meter or 70-centimeter repeater. You're likely to have some kind of vertical antenna, with the microphone gain and squelch set just so, and have your radio set for FM. I'm skipping over power, the electrical type, but that in itself can be a feat of endurance. After hunting around for a list of relevant frequencies, you might also have set up something like CTCSS to ensure that your signal actually gets acknowledged by the repeater. If that's not enough, you'll also have made your radio use an offset, which makes it receive using one frequency and transmit using another. There is possibly more things you've had to do to make this work, and not be subjected to the ire of the local repeater troll, who appears to delight in telling you off when they feel you've done something wrong, like leave the Roger beep activated or some other infraction. If you did manage to achieve all these things, and actually made your first contact on the repeater, congratulations, and welcome to the hobby. Take a breath. You did well. After a while, you're likely to become more familiar with your radio and start exploring the local bands. You might program another repeater into your radio and even experiment with local simplex frequencies. Each of these activities brings a new experience and new mistakes. For example, not all repeaters use the same offset, or even an offset in the same direction. Not all repeaters have the same CTCSS requirements. If you're using a simplex frequency, remember to turn off the squelch. Don't ask me how I know. So you have a chance to actually hear the other stations, even if you're using FM as the mode. The process of getting on air as a first-time user can be daunting, with many different points of failure along the way. Ignore the trolls, try your best and ask for help if you get stuck, and celebrate your accomplishment when you manage to make a contact. My point is that achieving all this isn't trivial, and it will be helpful if that's remembered from time to time. It's easy to dismiss an achievement made by another, but much more rewarding to celebrate it. I'm Ono, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima Alpha Bravo.
Now you can discover the mysteries of ham radio. Using modern transceivers, you can make friends all over the world, even talk to astronauts in space, ships on the high seas, and flying aircraft thousands of miles away. Unlike phone users, ham radio operators talk absolutely free and provide vital communications during disasters or emergencies. And remember, unlike the internet, we crisscross the entire globe wirelessly.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 'S ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechts bovenaan de webpagina van de uitzendingen www.pa0ete.nl. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De internetfaciliteiten en studiohardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl. 70MHzShop.nl. En het Remeiland ligt sinds... Het Remeiland ligt sinds 2011 in het IJ, waar het onder andere een... Het Remeiland ligt sinds... Nou, zeg.
En microfoon naar retour.
Voor de Echelink-gebruikers.